some stuff from Benjamin. I encourage you to read what he wrote, because he was teaching a class 4 hours away, and he said because of the funds we give, he was able to do this. And I would love to find a way to ship material, the extra material we have, because he's talking in there how they had to teach them to make a Sunday school lesson because they don't have any material whatsoever. So they were teaching them, I don't know if you've seen the pictures, they're holding up cards that say Jesus, and he was teaching them a Sunday school class that they could teach the children. But he talks about how people for this class, some of them walk 2 hours to come to that class. So, I mean, you know, and it just amazes me the hunger for Christ that people have there and are willing to do what they do. I mean, he went 4 hours to teach the class, and then he stayed in one town and had to go down. You can read it all there. I don't know what it all is on the top of head, but it's just a blessing to see it and know that we're contributing to that. I mean, with what we do, and he's very grateful for it. So, but next week we have a chance to minister again with the food pantry. Just be in prayer for that, and if you can participate, be here and participate. Well, let's go to Lord in song, starting with number 512. Jesus is all the world to me. Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trials sore. I go to him for blessings, and he gives them o'er and o'er. He sends the sunshine and the rain. He sends the harvest, golden grain. Sunshine and rain, harvest and grain. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, and true to him I'll be. Oh, how could I this friend deny, when he's so true to me? Following him I know I'm right. He watches o'er me day and night. Following him by day and night, he's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I trust him now, I'll trust him when life's fleeting day shall end. Beautiful life with such a friend. Beautiful life that has no end. Eternal life, eternal joy. He's my friend. Beautiful song. He is all the world to me. And he has a wonderful name, number 118. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Amen. Truly wonderful name, Jesus, and He is our Lord and Savior and King. And what a friend of sinners is He, number 17. No. Yeah, that's the right one. Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. He is with me to the end. Jesus, what a strength in weakness. Let me hide myself in Him. Tempest tried and sometimes failing, He my strength, my victory wins. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. What a help in sorrow, while the billows over me roll. Even when my heart is breaking, He, my comfort, helps my soul. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. He is with me to the end. Jesus, what a guide and keeper. While the tempest still is high, storms abound me, night o'ertakes me. He, my pilot, hears my cry. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. He is with me to the end. Jesus, I do now receive Him. More than all, in Him I find. He hath granted me forgiveness. I am His, and He is mine. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. He is with me to the end. Amen. What a lovely Savior we serve. And my Jesus, I love Thee, number 79.
my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say when the death dew lies cold on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
And if we love him so, we'll realize what he did for us, our last congregation hymn. He paid it all. 305.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power in thine alone can change a leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died to save my soul, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Share this song. It kind of goes along with the sermon. Next week will be the first week in December. We'll have our Lottie Moon Christmas offering starting next week. Remember that for the month of December, week of international missions. But if you've got something you want to share for Christmas, a song, a poem, a testimony, something, just let me know. I know I've got plenty of Christmas songs and everything that I can sing, but if the Lord's laying on your heart just to share something, just let me know and just share it with us on Sunday mornings. I'd be glad to let you. The storms come in life. I thought it was interesting, Lord. Give me this one's raining out.
In the dark of the midnight, have I oft hid my face while the storms howl above me? And there's no hiding place. With the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Storms come no more, I will stand in thy presence on that bright, peaceful shore, in that land where the tempest never comes. Lord, will I dwell with thee when the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand.
Get your Bibles out this morning and turn to Matthew 8, starting in verse 18. And when you find that, go over a book to Mark 4 in verse 35. I want to look at both of these accounts of the time Jesus calmed the storm, his 12th miracle that we look at this morning. There was a time in our country that something unbelievable happened. We never expected it. It was on Tuesday, September 11, 2001. In a short time, as small as an hour and a half, this happened. At 8:45 a.m., a jet airliner crashed into the North Tower of the World Trade Center in New York. At 9:03 a.m., a second airliner crashed into the Twin South Tower, causing a devastating explosion. At 9:10 a.m. in Florida, President Bush is reading to children in a classroom when the Chief of Staff, Andrew Card, whispers news of the attacks in his ear. At 9:20, the FBI reports of planes being hijacked before the World Trade Center crashes. At 9:29, first reports of casualties indicate that 6 people were killed and 1,000 injured. 9:30 a.m., President Bush declared, "We have had a national tragedy. 2 airplanes have crashed in the World Trade Center and a apparent terrorist attack on our country." 9:43 a.m., another plane crashes into the Pentagon in Washington. The nerve center of the U.S. military bursts into flame, and a portion of one side of the 5-sided structure collapses. 9:48 a.m., the White House and the Capitol are evacuated amid further threats. 9:49 a.m., all airports across the U.S. are shut down. 10 a.m., United Airlines Flight 93 en route to Newark, New Jersey, from New York, New Jersey to San Francisco, crashes near Pittsburgh. The crash site is 85 miles northwest of Camp David. 10:05 a.m., the South Tower of the World Trade Center collapses. 10:29 a.m., the North Tower collapses. Unbelievable that we could ever think something like that would happen in the history of the United States. But things are happening all over the world, even today, that almost seem unbelievable. Like I said earlier, COVID in the United States alone is taking a life every minute. We can't see our families. We can't go to funerals. Churches are closing. Our election has turned our political agenda upside down. People are burning towns. There's riots and marches. And people are drawing away from God instead of drawing to Him. Unbelievable. Today in our 12th miracle of Jesus is something that at that time was unbelievable. Matthew 8, starting in verse 18, says, "Now when Jesus saw great multitudes about Him, He gave a commandment to depart unto the other side. And a certain scribe came and said unto Him, Master, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And Jesus said unto him, The foxes have holes, and the birds have of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And another of his disciples said to him, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. But Jesus said unto him, Follow me, and let the dead bury their dead. And when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves. But he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, Why are you fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? And Mark chapter 4, starting in verse 35, is another account of this same time. It says, And in the same day, when the evening was come, He saith unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto them, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? Now is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, "What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your words. May we glean something from it this morning that will convict our hearts to be in your will. And Lord, may your Spirit use me as you see fit. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now just think, that storm came up. That storm to them at that time had to seem unbelievable. And it came up when they were following Jesus. Remember that. Why do you follow Christ? You know, there's usually two reasons. Some follow Christ for conveniences. In our verses in Matthew, it said, another disciple said unto him, "Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father." That seems like a reasonable request, doesn't it? To be able to go home and bury your father. But this issue was more complex than what it appears to be. Because evidently the father didn't recently die. Because if the father would have died recently, the young man wouldn't have been on the side of the lake at such a crucial time for his family. The young man did not give the kingdom his highest priority in his thinking. He embraced a delayed discipleship concept that allowed him to follow Christ when it was convenient for him. But Jesus told him, "Follow me and allow the dead to bury their own dead." You know, that's the same thing as the Lord saying, "Let those who are spiritually dead be wrapped up in the things of the world. You, as a disciple, have a higher calling to preach the kingdom." And so another disciple deserts the ranks. So we follow because it's convenient, or we follow because it's willing. It's in our will. It says they were following because they were committed. Verse 8:23 in Matthew says, "And when he was entered into the ship, his disciples followed him." They were committed to follow Christ wherever, no matter what. And yet, in our scripture, we see a great storm still came, even though they were following Christ. That's unbelievable. We think that nothing can happen to us. We're following Christ. We're doing what we're supposed to do. But yet a great storm comes. It's unbelievable to think that these things are happening in our United States. We're a Christian nation. But the storms still come. And when this storm came up, it was unbelievable. Verse 24 in Matthew says, "And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves." So all of a sudden, there was an interruption. The Sea of Galilee is transformed in from a lion to a lamb to a ravished lion. This placid lake became turbulent. The seas of churning waters arose over the ship. Some critics say that's not possible. There's no way a storm like that could happen on the Sea of Galilee. But if you understand the physical nature of the Sea of Galilee, where it is and the region it is, and consider the things that are happening, it happens all the time. The Sea of Galilee is part of the Great Jordan Rift. It measures only 14 miles north and south and 7 miles east and west. But surrounding the lake is the Galilean hills and the Golan Heights. The sea is 700 feet below sea level. So when things are okay around the Sea of Galilee, it's subtropical. It's a beautiful climate. It's pleasant weather year-round. If you journey around its shores, you'd see groves of banana trees and fruit growing. It's so majestic. But on the north is Mount Hermon. And on the top of Mount Hermon, there's a lot of snow. The cold winds from the higher elevation sometimes come down that natural land trough and it heads right to the Sea of Galilee. And we all know what happens when that cold air comes in underneath that warm air. We see it all the time in Arkansas. It meets that warm air and severe conditions start to occur. Now, the gospel writers might have not been meteorologists, but they provided a graphic bit of information about the storm that fits the description of what is happening. Luke tells us in verse 23, "There came down a storm of wind on the lake," in reference to them northern winds. But these winds were different. These winds created a furious, ferocious storm. The same word that is used to describe this storm is the same word that was used in Jonah 1:4 in the Hebrew language to talk about the storm that Jonah was caught up in. It would mean hurricane or squall. And every time this word was used, it was in conjunction with darkness. So not only did this storm come automatically, it turned dark out. And we've seen that before, where all of a sudden it's daytime and the storm comes up and it's pitch black outside. And you wonder what's fixing to happen. In the Greek, they use the word seismos, which is the word we get seismograph from. We use it to measure the intensity of earthquakes. Matthew was trying to paint a picture here of a sea quake or a tsunami. A ferocious, vicious storm. No more horrifying experience could be imagined to these sailors. Darkness closed in on the small vessels. Bitter, cold winds whipped around the sailors, hitting them on every end. It says waves mounted so high that they would be over the boat. Have you ever been on water like that? I've never been to where they've been over the boat, but I've been on Lake Erie before, and I didn't like it. You would sit there and you'd see the land, and then you wouldn't see the land. And then you'd see the land, and then you wouldn't see the land. I didn't stay out there long. I said, okay, it's time for me to go. But that's what this was like. They couldn't see. It says all these other boats, they couldn't see the other boats. All of a sudden, these waves were up over the boat. And to make matters worse, in Mark it tells us that the boat was filling with water faster than they could bail it out. It says it was filling with water. But the fact that makes this so unbelievable and that we need to understand is Christ was in the boat. They were following him. Yet the storm still came up. Listen, storms are the fact of life. They're going to happen to us whether we're Christian or not Christian. Job 5:7 says, "Yet man is born unto trouble as the sparks fly upward." 1 Peter 4:12-13 says, "Beloved, think it not strange, think it not unbelievable concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you." It says, "Rejoice in so much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceedingly joy." You know, unbelief comes along because we have the wrong expectation about storms that we should experience. After all, Christians should never have to go through a storm where we're in jeopardy. But Luke tells us they were. Mark's gospel adds an interesting side thing here. It says the disciples took Jesus along with them just as he was. They took along Jesus with him just as he was. You know, we need to take Jesus along with us just as he is, not construe him into something we want him to be. You know, sometimes we think, you know, well, I'll follow Jesus if he meets these conditions. Well, Lord, if you'll make sure this happens, and this happens, I'll be glad to follow you. You know, it's actually in Genesis 28. Jacob vowed a vow saying, "If the Lord will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God." He gave conditions to God. We don't need to give conditions to God. If we're doing that, guess what? The storm will surprise us. The storm will stop you. The storm will be unbelievable. But you know that something else was unbelievable happening here besides the storm? Jesus was sleeping. Could you imagine that? This ship's filling with water. The waves are coming over, and it says he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? The disciples were what? In a panic. They had nowhere else to turn. Now think about this. They didn't run to the master right away, did they? No. They did everything a sailor would do. They would raise their sails. They would jim the rig. They would play with the rudder. They would do everything that a sailor would do before they went to the Savior. They thought the time was hopeless. They thought, let's awaken the Master. John MacArthur said, when sailors ask a foreman carpenter to do what to do in a storm, you know they're in a lot of trouble. I mean, Jesus was a carpenter. What's he going to know about storms? They didn't think he could do anything about it. Do you ever pray and it seems like the Lord's sleeping? Does it make you say, carest thou not that we perish, Lord? Have you ever thought that in our election? Lord, carest not? Lord, we're praying to you. We're doing everything. We've seen revivals. We've seen so many things happening. We're praying over a nation. And Lord, look what's happening. Don't you care? And we think that maybe God doesn't seem to hear us, or it doesn't seem as if he really cares. Listen, Jesus never rescues those who are intent upon saving themselves. He was asleep on the pillow. As long as we think we can handle it, guess what? He's going to allow you to handle it. He's not going to come rescue. He's going to let you try. They bailed. They did everything they knew what to do as sailors before they went up to him and woke him up. Don't you care? You think these fishermen were going to ask a carpenter how to sail? As a nation, many are upset that God is allowing all this to happen. Is he asleep? And they're wondering what's happening. They're saying, Christians, why do you pray to this God? But are they interested in God's will when we slaughter 40 million children? Where are they then? You don't hear anything about that. 40 million innocent babies dying. You know, there used to be a bumper sticker that you would see a lot. It said, Jesus is my co-pilot. It's essential in our Christian life to recognize Jesus is not a passenger. He's our pilot. He's the one that controls our life. We ought to never say, I receive you, get in the back. And that's what we do sometimes. I'll pilot the ship. I'll set my own course. If I need you, I'll call you. Go take a nap. We never feel the need until the storm comes. But it's not just that the storm comes, we almost perish. But you know, that's precisely why the storms come. Because we wait till that time to go to him. Yeah, there's always an end to a rope. And what does the world tell us to do? What do they tell you? The best advice to do when you're at the end of your rope? Tie a knot and then hang on, right? And know what the world says? When you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot and hang it on. You're never going to get anywhere hanging on the end of a rope. You have to let go. You have to let go of that rope. That's the right answer in life. We don't get to the end of our rope and hang on. We let go and let Jesus catch us. The storm was unbelievable. It's unbelievable that the Lord's asleep. But what's the most unbelievable thing to them is the fact that the Lord speaks. And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? Why is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? What kind of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? There's only one answer. There's only one man, and he is God and man in one, Jesus Christ. Psalms 89:8-9 says, O Lord God of hosts, who is a strong Lord like unto thee? Or to thy faithfulness round about thee? Thou rulest the raging of the sea, when the waves thereof arise, thou stillest them. To the Lord, our fear and lack of faith is unbelievable. When you have a small God, he can't do much. Why are you fearful? How is it that you have no faith? They weren't trusting in his word. What did Jesus tell him at the beginning of this? He said, get in the boat, we're going to the other side. Jesus didn't say, get in the boat, we're going down to the bottom of the sea. He said, get in the boat, let us pass over. We don't trust his word. He's given us his promises over and over again, and they weren't trusting in his word when he said, get in the boat, we're going over to the other side. They weren't trusting in his will. His will was to pass over. His will and his word are the same. And the safest place in this world is in the will of God, even on a lake in a storm. You know, Paul believed that God had a purpose for him, that God had a job for him to do. And I can't imagine God saving a soul through the blood of his son, Jesus Christ, and not having a purpose or a job for that person's life. And something else I believe, and I say I come to this gradually. I believe that if you will find the will of God, and you will honestly put your life in the hands of the Lord to do the job that God has for you to do and stay on the job until it's done, that all the devils of hell can't stop you and nothing in this world is going to kill you until you're done. When you are in the will of God and you allow God to dictate your life, and you do what he's calling you to do, it doesn't matter what's thrown at you. It's not going to stop you from doing his will till he says you're finished. And then you'll hear the words, well done, my good and faithful servant. Nothing on earth can defeat you nor stop you from that job till it's done. But you have to be in the will of God and honestly trying to do the thing that God has for you to do. Look at Paul for a minute. He was concerned about just one thing from the day he was saved. What was it? It was to finish the job God cut him out for. He went down to Jerusalem for the last time, and everywhere he went, you can imagine the people telling him, Paul, they're going to kill you if you get down there. Paul, they're going to throw you in jail if you get down there. But what did Paul say in Acts 20:24? But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus Christ to testify the gospel of grace of God. God used the greatest injustice of all times for the salvation of man, the cross. The cross was not something Jesus looked forward to, but he recognized it as the will of God and committed himself to do God's will. So why are we so fearful? Why is it we have no faith? Because we're not trusting in the word of God. We're not confident in the will of God. We're not mindful of the presence of God. Jesus was in the boat with them, Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Isaiah 41:10. The faith that casts our fear recognizes that unseen presence. Thomas Andrew Dorsey, a black jazz musician from Atlanta, in the 20s gained a certain amount of notoriety as a composer of jazz tunes with suggestive lyrics. But he gave that all up in 1926 when he started to concentrate on spiritual music when the Lord touched his life. He penned the song we know, Peace in the Valley, one of the best known songs. But there's a story behind his most famous song that deserves to be told. In 1932, times were hard for Dorsey. Trying to survive the Depression years as a working musician meant tough going. On top of that, his music was not accepted by many people. Some said it was too worldly. The devil's music, they called it. Many years later, Dorsey could laugh about it. He said, you know, I've been kicked out of some of the best churches in the land. But the real kick in the teeth came one night in St. Louis when he received a telegram informing him that his pregnant wife died suddenly. Dorsey was filled with grief that his faith was shaken to the roots. But instead of wallowing in self-pity, he turned to the discipline he knew best, music. In the midst of agony, he wrote these lyrics. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. The storm that night was unbelievable. It seemed unbelievable to them that the Lord would sleep at such a time. But the most unbelievable thing to them was when the Lord spoke and the wind listened. We need to listen to that small, still voice in our souls as the Spirit guides us. And all the things of this world that seem unbelievable to us will be nothing compared to the unbelievable things that the Lord is doing and wants to do through us and for us. We need to learn to look with our spiritual eyes and see. And the storm may come, but we'll find peace in it. What a blessing. The Lord's in our boat if we're His. He's with us. We looked at that this morning. The Spirit's here with us, guiding us, directing us. It's just amazing how all these people that should be drawing closer to the Lord are drawing farther from the Lord. When this is over and they allow churches to open back up, they'll probably be empty. You'll see bigger churches that look like ours. Because the storms are coming and people think the Lord's abandoned them. Because they're trying to do it themselves. And we here never do it ourselves and always rely on the Lord for all the things we do. And trust Him in the storm. Let us pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father. Lord, we just thank You that You're there. And Lord, if we look to You first, the storm would have never overtaken the boat. Because You would have calmed the winds long before. But Lord, You commanded that they go to the other side. Lord, You give us a command to do Your will while we're here. And as long as we obey that command, nothing should surprise us. We've got a will to do. You commanded us. You've guided us. And Lord, may we heed to your will and your direction and your guidance. No better time than this. And what a blessing it is to serve you in the midst of the storm and know that you're in control. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Let's all stand, number 504. Without him, we cannot do it. I love how this verse fits in. Without him, I could do nothing. Without him, I surely fail. Without him, I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know him today? Do not turn him away. Oh Jesus, oh Jesus, without him, how lost I would be. Well, thank y'all for being here this morning. Pray for all those who didn't make it this morning. Let's check up on them and make sure everybody's doing all right. Hopefully it's just the weather that's keeping people out. Don't let the storm stop you. We don't need to let the storm stop us. He's in control. He's got it taken care of. Let's pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we've had to come together and worship you this morning. Lord, what a joy it's been to be in your presence, sing praises to you, uplift your name in song and in word, and just worship you. And Lord, may that worship continue as we go through our daily routines, and may we reach those for your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.